हेलो फ्रेंड्स, हाउ आर यू? नाउ वी आर गोइंग फॉर द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ इट. एक्चुअली प्रीवियसली आई हैव डिसाइडेड टू टेक दिस प्रेजेंटेशन इन थ्री पार्ट, बट द थर्ड पार्ट इज बिकमिंग लिटिल बिट लेनियर, देयरफॉर आई हैव मेड इट इन अ फोर पार्ट. द फार्माकोथेरेपी आई हैव डिवाइडेड इन टू टू पार्ट्स. ओके, द एड्रेनर्जिक सिस्टम एंड डायबिटिक्स इन वन पार्ट, एंड रेनिन एंजियोटेंसिन सिस्टम एनालॉग्स इन सेकेंड. सो देर विल बी थ्री एंड फोर पार्ट. So today, here we are dealing with the third part of the pharmacotherapy of congestive heart failure. Now, various adrenergic agents we have already seen in previous adrenergic system also. So the same adrenergic agents here we can use either alpha blockers and beta blockers. So from the alpha blocker category, the drug prazosin is renownedly used. So it decreases your peripheral resistance. Venous capacitance is also reduced by producing the atrioventricular, arteries and venous dilations. It dilates the arteries as well as veins. So venous capacitance is also decreases. The major thing that it retains the water and the salt. So it attenuates the antihypertensive, the major drawback of these alpha blockers. So water retention and salt retention, this is main drawback of it, which is leading to the antagonize the antihypertensive. So another drawback is orthostatic hypotension, postural hypotension, is also known as when you change your posture from one place to the other. If you are sleeping, you are normal. Whenever you are sitting, you are normal. But if you change from sitting to the sleeping or sleeping to the sitting, if you change the posture, you feel little bit change the disturbance into the hypertension, and you are slightly, you are going into the hypotension state, and you will feel like a vertigo. So that is one of the drawback of orthostatic alpha blockers. The next category from the adrenergics is the beta blocker. These beta blockers, well known, is the propranolol. They reduces the sympathetic outflow, and majorly they are used in hypertension. Propranolol should be given in a cautious when there is a patient of asthma or COPD, because it blocks the beta receptors non-specifically, and therefore there can be a precipitation of this asthma or COPD conditions. With more selective agents like metoprolol, atoprolol, atenolol, these are used. So therefore the disadvantage of precipitation of asthma and all these things has been reduced in these days for the beta blockers. So the next category is arteriodilators. Hydralazine and minoxidil, these are the two compounds which are from the arteriodilators. They dilate the arteries. Hydralazine, they are directly working on the arterial smooth muscle without any mediator, like other mediators work through the receptor mechanism or by releasing the nitrous oxide, etc., etc. Like this, it is not like that way. Hydralazine directly work on that muscle, smooth muscles of the arteries, and they are mediating. They cause this reflex sympathetic activity. This is one of the major drawback which is related to hydralazine. Reflex sympathetic activity, tachycardia, myocardial contractility, increased plasma renin activity, and fluid retention. These are the reflex activity. Reflex means when the amount of hydralazine reduces down, at that time they may precipitate this kind of activity. Like sympathetic activity is enhanced, so tachycardia, these are the side effects they are getting. So decreased peripheral resistance and hence may call the failure in the blood pressure. So whenever there is a vasodilation, this may lead to the excessive failure in the blood pressure, and the patient may go in a hypotensive crisis or hypotensive conditions. So it will not stop at the particular normal movement rather than hypertension to the normal and stoppage over there. Instead of that, if something happens, it will, may go below that, and there can be a failure in the blood pressure also. So this is what about hydralazine. Next drug is minoxidil. So actually this drug is a prodrug. It is converted into its active metabolite, the sulfate kind of a drug. and causes the vasodilation by working on the potassium channel. They do not dilate the veins, they are only the arteriodilators, and hence the postural hypotension, this type of adverse effect is not observed, because this postural hypotension type of things is related to the venous, the blood which is present in the veins. It is correlated with that. So it does not act on the veins, therefore postural hypotension, this kind of a thing is not observed with the mirabegron. It causes the increase in myocardial contractility, heart rate, myocardial oxygen consumption, which is blocked by the beta blocker. This is one of the actions of the mirabegron. It is used in a moderate to severe hypertensive condition in combination with the diuretics, and specifically these are highly potent agents, therefore they are not given in alone. They are always combined with other antihypertensive agents and beta blockers and diuretics. So this is what about the drugs as arteriodilators. So the next category is the arteriovenodilator. The very promising compound in that is the sodium nitroprusside. Sodium nitroprusside is a very good therapeutic agent, but clinically it is not used. We cannot say it is not used. In a specific condition it can be given, but in general they are not given. We will see that why it is not given. So it dilates both the arteries and veins. There is a decrease in peripheral resistance and fails the blood pressure, and after load is also decreased. After load means whenever there is an ejection of a blood, at that time the load that it will be reduced by the sodium nitroprusside. So peripheral venodilation leading to the venous pooling and decrease in the preload. So preload means filling of that blood, coming the blood towards the heart. So venodilation will lead to the accommodation of a fluid in the venous, that is pooling, the blood will be pooled towards the vein. So there is a venodilation, so accommodation of a fluid inside the veins will be maximum, and the preload, load on the heart will be reduced down. So cardiac output is also improved, and therefore the afterload is also reduced. So amount which is remaining, and after ejection some of the load, if it is remaining over there, that is also reduced, because cardiac output is improved. The throwing of the blood out of the heart is improved. So net, there is a net effect, there is a reduced in preload as well as afterload. So net, there is a very clinically beneficial effect we are getting. And the mechanism of action, if you see, the vasodilation is produced by increasing the cyclic GMP level. Cyclic GMP level is increased, and due to that there is a liberation of the nitric oxide. Facilitate this nitric oxide, facilitate the vasodilation. Arteries are as well as vein. So cyclic GMP level is increased, that liberates the nitric oxide, and then this nitric oxide works on the arteries and vein. The major drawback why sodium nitroprusside is not popular as a vasodilator, because it is rapidly uptaken by the RBC, and it combines with the hemoglobin to form a cyanomethylglobulin and a cyanide compound. So there is a reaction of this compound with the hemoglobin. So the impairment of hemoglobin function is there, and as well as what toxic substance is also produced, which is known as cyanide. This cyanide is very poisonous and produces the cellular oxidative metabolic processes. And therefore there is a side effect of it, failing the blood pressure, reflex tachycardia, accumulation of cyanide. These are the typical side effects of this sodium nitroprusside. Thiocyanate interferes with the iodine uptake also and produces hypothyroidism. So accumulation of cyanide, interference with the sodium iodine uptake, and hypothyroidism, production of hypothyroidism, which is the limitation. Therefore this nitroprusside is not used as a popular vasodilator. So the next category will be calcium channel blocker. They act by the different mechanisms. But we have already seen that calcium channels, so calcium ions in actin myosin filament electrophysiology, we have seen what is the role of that calcium ions over here. So similar here, they are by the same mechanism they are working over here. So So their pharmacological effects whatsoever on the heart and all this cardiovascular system are very similar to that of the beta blockers. So only the thing is that they are working by the different mechanism. Beta blockers work by the receptor mechanism, whereas the calcium channel blockers act by the calcium channels. They are also used in a various clinical condition of cardiovascular system like hypertension, angina, arrhythmia, and therefore they are also effective agent, because all the CHF is all the complications of the conditions like hypertension, angina, and arrhythmia. So if then they are used in these conditions, it can be also used in clinical conditions of the congestive heart failure. They are used extensively in a migraine, then premature labor, renal failure, dermatological condition. The smooth muscles of the blood vessels, heart, where the calcium entry is blocked and preventing the contractions. They have also a predominant action on the calcium gated channel. So blocking of this calcium channel causes the relaxation of smooth muscles and the myocardium. Calcium channel blockers, they block these calcium channels and there is a relaxation. So contraction is inhibited, so myocardial muscle relaxation will take place. They have specifically working, they work by the two receptor, one in a smooth muscle and another is a pacemaker. One which is in the pacemaker cells that are different and one which is in a smooth muscle are different. These calcium channel blockers prevent the binding of calcium in troponin, that is in actin myosin complex formation. It is working on that. So thus it decreases the contractility and produces negative chronotropic and allotropic effect. They relaxes the smooth muscle and prevent the platelet aggregations, these calcium channel blockers. So the last part is our diuretics. Diuretics, they causes the depletion of sodium and consequently there is a loss of fluid from the body. The consequences of accumulation of oedema can be reduced by the drugs which are known as diuretics. They decreases the blood pressure and the cardiac output by loss of the water and electrolytes, that is mainly the sodium. They reduces the blood pressure and by that way they also compensate the cardiac output. Initially there can be a slight elevation into the peripheral muscular resistance, but later on by the compensation mechanism this is normalized. Diuretics are capable of effectively reducing the blood pressure up to 10 to 15 mmHg. Whatever the elevated blood pressure by 10 to 15 mmHg, that can be reduced by the diuretic agents. Mostly they are combined with the vasodilators and beta blockers. They are not given because they are very drastic in their action. So thiazides, they are the mild to moderate type of IT hypertensive agents. They are used. Loops diuretics, they are like furosemides. They are effective in severe conditions. Potassium sparing diuretics, they are also used in conditions like CHF. So depending upon the how you require the therapeutic efficacy, how much if you require the moderate, then thiazides. If you require the severe, then loop diuretic. Specific conditions, then potassium sparing. So there is a potassium sparing there. The potassium is spared for the sodium. So there can be hypokalemia, which is the most common side effect which is related to the diuretics. Hypokalemia, these conditions may lead to the precipitation of arrhythmia also. So it is one of the common side effect which may become serious if not managed properly. So this is how the diuretics are working. So here we finish our third part, and in the fourth part we will do with the pharmacotherapy related to the drugs acting on the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Thank you.